This is another iRaw podcast. We podcast to make the world a better place for animals.
Dr. Siobhan O'Sullivan does like knowing animals. Dr. Siobhan O'Sullivan does like knowing animals.
Hey people, welcome to Knowing Animals. Knowing Animals is a podcast where we speak to animal studies scholars about a piece of their work. I'm Siobhan O'Sullivan and I do like knowing animals. Well, this episode of Knowing Animals is brought to you by the wonderful people at AASA. AASA is the Australasian Animal Studies Association. AASA is looking for members. Information about subs was recently sent out to former members. AASA really does need people to think about joining in order to allow the organisation to continue its good work supporting animal studies scholars. Membership is just $15 for the unwaged and $60 for the waged. So think about joining AASA, the Australasian Animal Studies Association. Needless to say, I am a member. This episode is also brought to you by the wonderful people at Animal Publix. Animal Publix is part of Sydney University Press. It is a curated book series with a focus on animal issues, and it is really wonderful. There are a lot of titles already available over at Animal Publix. They've got a nice little section of the website dedicated to the animal studies books. And they're always looking for new authors to get involved. So whether you're looking to buy animal studies books or perhaps submit a manuscript, keep Animal Publix at Sydney University Press in mind. Okay, let's get down to business. Well, this is another episode of Knowing Animals that is being recorded during the time of coronavirus. So that means that I'm not in the same room as my guest, but it also does mean that I'm able to speak to people who otherwise perhaps wouldn't have been available to me. So my guest this week is a return guest. I'm joined by Laura Jean Mackay. Now, is it Mackay or McKay?
Hi, it's McKay.
But McKay.
There is a huge clan of Mackays that I'm sure would be happy with that pronunciation.
So it's Laura Jean Mackay. Is that what I immediately forget what people say about their name? So it's Mackay.
McKay.
McKay. Now, Laura is lecturer in the School of English and Media Studies at Massey University, which, of course, is in New Zealand. And today we're going to discuss Laura's new novel, The Animals in That Country, which was published by Scribe in 2020. It's just come out. Welcome to the podcast, Laura.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here again.
It's wonderful to have you back. And last time we spoke, the manuscript was still in its final production. We did have a bit of a chat about it. So it's really wonderful to be holding a copy of the book in my hand. So, Laura, can you start by telling us what inspired this work?
Sure. I'm also as excited as you to be holding copies of The Animals in That Country in my hands too. I remember talking to you when I was in those final stages, and it was just such a big book to write. So it's nice to see it in print and to have other people reading it and to be able to talk with you, Siobhan, about it. This book really started about 7 years ago. I was thinking a lot about animals, and I was living in the bush at a writer's residency. And I guess I was surrounded by creatures. There were ducks wandering through my writer's studio. There were snakes, and there were mobs of kangaroos. This is in a place near Eltham, and in Victoria. And I came across this kangaroo who was a rogue, and we just bumped into each other, and we should have been very scared of each other, but we actually weren't. We just sort of stared at each other in mutual recognition. And I think I actually talked about this in the last podcast I did with you, Siobhan, because we were talking about a story called King that came from that was written in the first person voice of this kangaroo. But it didn't just stop at the short story. I just couldn't stop thinking about this connection that I seemed to have with this very, very different creature. And I also started thinking about what it is that humans seem to think that separates us from the rest of the animal world. And what keeps coming up again and again, and this is, I guess, from Aristotelian times, is the idea that language is our key separator, the language barrier. Humans have language, so apparently we are so much better than all the other animals, which of course isn't true. So I thought, well, what would happen if I took away that barrier? What would happen if we had a shared communication, if we could understand what animals are saying with their quite extraordinary bodies through smell, through sounds, microscopic sounds that humans can't hear because we're not developed in that way, through certain twitches and shivers. And so this language started to develop on the bodies of the animal characters that I was writing. And that really launched this whole inquiry into how animal bodies might speak in the novel and also how humans react to that. How would we actually feel if we could speak to other animals? Would they say what we think that they are saying? Would Fluffy, you know, is Fluffy actually saying, I love you, I love you? Or does Fluffy have some other opinions about us that might be a bit confronting?
So, Laura, I've been reading the book and really, really enjoying it. And from my perspective, perhaps because I know you, or perhaps it's the circles I move in, I don't know, but my sense is that there was a lot of anticipation around the novel, and a few people had told me that they'd read it and it was amazing. And I had a sense of what it was about, and also because I've chatted to you about it before. So what my first impression when the animals began to speak, I was expecting them to come out with fully formed, you know, ways of communicating, and I was expecting them to rise and, you know, speak like me, but of course they don't. Can you say something about the thinking behind the mode of communication that evolves in the novel even once it becomes possible for this communication to take place?
Well, we have to remember that in the novel, the communication from the animal bodies is translated or mediated by the humans that are perceiving it. So at the start, it's really Jean, the narrator's fault that the animal language isn't coming through so clearly. She gets told this by her granddaughter, she's just not listening hard enough. She's not watching their bodies well enough. And the granddaughter teaches Jean to put together the message from the wag of a dingo's tail and the twitch of an ear and the scent that's coming out of somewhere, and put them all together and look at the whole picture of the animal. So I was really interested in how the language might develop through human perception. At the beginning, particularly when Jean talks to Sue, she perceives Sue as calling her queen. So it's a very imperial language that comes through there. But as Jean gets to know Sue a little better, and as the power shifts in the novel, Sue stops calling her queen and starts calling her cat dog and lick spittle and bitch and things that Jean isn't as happy about, but that are perhaps more true to the way that Sue and Jean are relating to each other. Another aspect of the way that the animal dialogue is represented on the page is that I wanted something that was very non-human and also that didn't fall into the usual tropes of the way that we have animals speak in literature. So the animals aren't prophetic, they're not particularly poetic, they don't have truths and great wisdoms to bestow on us. In fact, they don't really care as much about us as we think they do. And so, of course, I don't really know what a mosquito is saying, but it was very fun to play with font. All the insects in the novel tend to fling themselves through the air and shout gleefully. The birds tend to have italics and emphasize separate words. The mammals often have little asides and brackets when they speak. And Sue, in particular, because dingoes have such a contentious place in the human imagination in Australia, we like to categorize them, but we're not quite sure how. We call them feral, we call them native, we call them introduced, we call them pests, we call them pets. And I wanted Sue's dialogue and character to reflect the many experiences that she's had. So she's a dingo who was taken from the place that she was born and put to work as a show animal. So she is a wild animal and she has that wild experience and longing in her, but she also has a lived experience of living behind a cage and being fed every day and being part of an institution. So Sue will often, say things in brackets, like she'll say, you know, she might say, "I love you." And then as an aside, she'll say, "No, I don't." So she's constantly got this sort of angel devil dingo on her shoulders, offering two sides of the story.
Wow. Well, Laura, I know that we discussed the possibility of you reading a section, and I just wonder whether now might be a good time for you to give us a little excerpt from the novel before we continue our discussion of it, because it might set the tone a little bit.
Absolutely. So I'm just going to read a bit where Jean is basically the human character, has basically been going around and everyone seems to be getting sick from this strange new flu, and she's aware that people are able to talk to animals, and she's a bit miffed, frankly, that she hasn't got that ability yet. So she works in a wildlife park. Previously she's been a guide, but now she's been suddenly promoted to ranger because everyone else is losing it over talking to animals. So she's got some more responsibility now. So this is on page 74 for anyone reading along. Inside the food store, it's quiet and empty, cool metal prep tables in the snot-coloured dim. My body has sucked all the heat from the day to radiate it back out through the slash in my fucked-up hand. Expect steam when I wash the burning skin in the sink. The water hurts my face and I shiver, now freezing. Drag the cold room jacket on and collapse onto the gurney we use to examine sick beasts. I'm there like a bat with her wings clutched, my ancient fingers grabbing the air. The shivers pass again into heat, then cold again, but not as bad. After the next flush, I feel good enough to sit up and take the jacket off, wet with sweat. A spider sits splay-legged in the corner, watching a fat blowfly do wheelies through the air. Someone runs past the food store with a sound that is half laugh, half cry. I snort my nose on a bit of paper towel and the room stinks like antiseptic, hay, rotting fruit and mice. The feed in the buckets is waiting to be dished out, half-rotten fruit that needs to be used today or it's gone. It's just you now, Genie Queen, I tell myself, edging off the gurney, legs steady enough. Business as usual. Whistle through my teeth like some cartoon rooster, reeling around the food store, saving the day. Keep my sore hand out of the way and go at it one-handed. Kibble in my pockets for bribes and treats. Get going on the mouse feed, the grains, the seeds, the pellets. Whispering. It must be Doug talking to his baby wallaroo. I got real work to do. I grab a couple of soft apples and dice them up wonkily with a big dirty knife on a chopping board stained with fruit from yesterday or the day before. No time for cleaning. The voices grow louder but muffled. I'm busy in here, I shout, give the bucket a mix with my hand. Can't hear you. The voices stop, start up again. Yellow mist, a sickly gas, seeps from behind the swing doors that lead to the hall, the mouse rooms, and the gas chamber. The pipes must be busted, the gas left on. It curls like clouds, leaking poison under the door. If it kills those mice, we'll be buggered, nothing to feed the snakes or the raptors. I dump the bucket, take a gulp of fresh air, and launch through the doors, beating at the off switch with my grimy hand. It's already off. No gas. Gas. Wisps from the mouse room must have leaked in there. All the breeding pairs will be dead. The whispers louder, I can almost make out words. Hello? The gas is thick. They'll all be dead. I haul open the heavy doors to see if I can save even a couple of them. Dozens of mice sit up on their haunches, alive, horrified. Gas rising not from the pipes, but from their bodies. Not squeaking, screaming. They scream bloody murder, the death of everyone. Death in the cages and death in the walls. All the little kids in the whole world die. My poor old dad reaches out from his early grave. Disease eats my face, crunches my bones until I'm rotting, empty, sucked dry by raptors. Bones left to dust. I fall back, fumbling. What's left of my body? Blood and bits, a carcass, but I'm whole. The mice are whole. I'm going fucking crazy. There's no screaming, just a whole bunch of fat-assed mice with their noses in the air. Run! I look around. Someone has said it, clear as speech. I'm in here, I call out to Doug. Run! It's glands from the body, it's crops and killing and shelter. No, it's... who's talking? It's just Jean. The small white bodies in the cages shiver, gases rise off them, and a squeak comes out, and together they make run. On a hillside, run to the wall. You go, I'll make my way, one and everyone, everything, the body, run. I run. And I'll stop there.
Wow, amazing. And so beautifully written and beautifully read as well.
Thank you.
Laura, the novel opens at a zoo and you take us, we meet a lot of animals in a lot of different contexts. Can you say something about your choice of settings, why it mattered to go through a range of different, I guess, animal environments?
I got a writer's residency to go and live up north in the Northern Territory Wildlife Park. And as part of that, I hired a caravan and parked it under a ranger's house. And it meant I was actually living inside the park. So I was there 24 hours a day. When they locked up the park at night and everyone else went home, I was still there with them. So I could hear the captive animals in their enclosures, but also often their wild counterparts outside of the enclosures. So at night, the barking owl, which is a beautiful Northern Territory bird, would woof woof from their enclosure, and up above, the wild barking owls would call out woof woof down to them. So there was this real interesting sort of juxtaposition between between captive and wild, and what that meant. And after a while, in a way, I felt like I was one of the exhibits as well in my caravan, where people could walk past and look in at me writing about these animals. And so really it was the luck of the draw. I was searching for a place to discuss the idea of human and animal relationships and the idea of interspecies communication. And I was very, very lucky that the wildlife park accepted me into their program. And once I was there, walking these beautiful hot roads, looking at wild and captive creatures, I realized that what better place to start to examine the very strange relationship that we have with other animals than in a place where we go to see animals often, and often the only reason that we can see them, or the only reason that they still exist, is because they are in these wildlife parks. A lot of them are endangered, bordering on extinction. So I thought that was a really fascinating place to live and a fascinating setting.
So this novel is available, of course, as a novel for anyone to buy and read, and I hope that a lot of people do buy and read it. But I also get the sense that this could be a really good contribution or addition to literature study, animal studies courses, where there's a literature component, or indeed literature courses with an animal studies focus. And I guess probably your hope is that people will read it and get a lot of different things from it. But putting on your bit of your animal studies, I guess, hat or lens, what do you think perhaps are the key themes or messages or insights that people might be able to get from this book?
Well, animal studies is my real passion. I did a PhD, I guess, in creative writing and animal studies, and it was such an insight to me the first time I went to a reading group, which I think is also called Knowing Animals in Melbourne. Is that right?
I started it.
You started that, yeah, which absolutely – I was studying creative writing and feeling very frustrated about the opinions that were expressed about the role of animals in literature. Animals were there to operate as mirrors for human meaning. And I didn't feel that was necessarily the case. Surely there was more, and I started to read other books like Suniti Nam Joshi's Conversations of Cow and Eva Hornung's Dog Boy, and seeing that animals were treated in literature in a very different way. So when I realised there was this incredible group of dedicated, funny, extraordinary people called the Animal Studies Community, and I was welcomed into that, it really changed my perspective and really, really influenced the book in very strong ways. So in answer to your question, key themes, very much human non-human animal connection, and also misconnection, and human non-human animal understanding and misunderstanding. I think it's very important to look at the mistakes that we make as well as the deep connection. I think there's a lot to be looked into in terms of Val Plumwood's theories of speaking meat. Val Plumwood is, of course, the eco-feminist theorist Australian who really pioneered this concept of speaking meat and looking at animals in literature and pop culture and what they might be saying. I also think there's a real opening in literary animal studies, and I draw inspiration from theorists like Susan McHugh in that area and Robert McKay. I think he's a McKay, not a Mackay. looking, as I said, at how we represent non-human animals in literature and the theories around representation, which look also at voicelessness and who should speak for others, but also how non-human animals can be for and of themselves within a story. They don't need to represent human meaning. And in fact, maybe the human characters sometimes represent animal meaning. How can agency be investigated through literary representations of animals? And how can we look at the idea of decentering human characters in order to try to understand the non-human world and the possibilities there?
Wonderful. Well, Laura, I don't know if we've made it explicitly clear in this interview yet, but of course, what facilitates the communication is some kind of pandemic. And presumably when you started writing this book 7 years ago, you didn't imagine that it would come out just as we do go through a, you know, global pandemic. What's it been like releasing such a timely book?
It has been so strange. I didn't imagine that we would go through this time in history, which was perhaps rather naive of me. I used to work in aid work, and I helped to respond to things like the SARS epidemic. But really, the flu in, which is called zoo flu in the animals in that country, is really a plot line to enable people to be able to understand what other animals are saying. And it seemed to me very far-fetched at the time. In fact, I often hid from people that I was writing a pandemic or an epidemic novel because it didn't seem like something that would be was conceivable. It seemed, you know, that people could relate to. But of course, closer to publication, it became clearer and clearer that there were scenes in the novel that were playing out in the media, looting in shops and the whether to or not to wear a face mask, isolation, needing to lock down. But nobody in our world has yet been able to talk to animals from the current pandemic as yet.
No, but I do think it's quite interesting. My sense is that perhaps it will not be sustained, but I think this has generated some different types of thinking and some different ways of being in the world. And I know we've talked previously about the perception that there is more bird activity at the moment. And so it is quite interesting, though. It isn't just the pandemic, it affects something about the world we live in as well. And
yeah, the sort of animal turn within the pandemic has been really, really interesting, with people very much, we've talked about this before, Siobhan, people relying on pets for companionship and closeness more than ever. People noticing bird life with the absence of noise pollution and air pollution, strange stories of penguins taking over Welsh towns and rats rampaging through Sydney. I think that in a way it has been, even though it is such an awful situation and so devastating, there has been an interesting realization, I think, of our vulnerability and maybe that we do rely on the non-human animal world more than we think, and that what we're doing to the environment and to accelerate species extinction, we need to really pay attention to that. We need them.
Now, Laura, I may have asked you this last time you were on the program. I can't recall, but I'm certain that there'd be a lot of people listening who would love to write a novel, myself included. They feel they've got something to say. What's your advice to people who feel they've got a novel in them? How do they get it out?
A lot of people say that people should take a break and take time away from writing and think about it a lot. I'm really the opposite. I have to say it doesn't do great things for my health, but I really think that if you have a strong idea, if you have that clear image of what you want to do, you should just throw yourself at the paper or the screen repeatedly and just keep on working and write through the idea. I had to rewrite The Animals in That Country 3 times from scratch pretty much, because the ideas that I was working with were so complex. It's really quite hard to get a mosquito to have a viable conversation on a page. And I knew I had to get it right. And I did have people saying to me, you know, maybe you should give up and this isn't the novel, you know, it's not going to work. But I had such a clear conviction and a clear image. So I would say for people, if they do have that image, go for it. But another piece of advice I would give would be to write some short pieces first. Try and write a short story or an article first and see what comes out. And you'll know by the end of it if your idea has been fulfilled. Maybe it is actually just a 3,000 word piece, or maybe there's more to it. And that's what happened with me. I was writing kangaroo stories and chicken stories, and I realized that there was a lot more to it than a 2,000 word piece.
Wonderful, wonderful advice. Well, Laura, I ask everyone who comes on the program to answer quick questions. You're a return guest, so in your case, it's 4 quick questions.
Oh, goodness.
Are you ready for your 4 quick questions?
I am.
Okay, well, what's been the most satisfying or rewarding aspect of conducting animal studies research, or in your case, perhaps writing in the field?
It would have to be the complete change in mindset towards non-human animals. I can't have a fly in the house without having a bit of a chat to them now, which my partner thinks is disturbing and amusing. I'm really interested. I'm endlessly interested. Oh, sorry, it's just started raining torrentially here, if you can hear that. I think that the way that animals might be communicating is forever changed for me. And and that's really exciting. It's quite a, because there is so much sadness in doing animal studies, the way that we treat and use other animals, once you start looking into it, or you don't have to scratch the surface very much, it's really traumatic. And so there is also a huge joy in exploring animal characters and animal studies, in the sort of new insights it gives to your idea about other animals.
Well, what's been the most challenging or disheartening aspect?
I think it would have to be the frustration at the way we continue to use animals for our own benefit. Factory farming or any sort of animal farming is just desperately sad. Where I'm living now in New Zealand, in rural New Zealand, there's a huge rise in cow farming, in dairy and farming cows for meat. And every day I ride past cattle farms and I see many stages of the cow's possible experience. There's the calves who've just been taken away from their mothers. There's the bigger cows who may or may not be the mothers. And then there's a field where there's a field of cows who have sort of a hole in their side and they're being experimented on for some reason. And they're always, those cows in that field are always really keen to come over to the fence and have a sniff and sort of interact. And I just find, I just can't help but see them as trapped and in a hopeless cycle of torture. And the fact that keeps going, and that even though I've spent the last 7 years thinking about this and writing about it, I still feel powerless. So it's really the frustration.
Yeah. Well, Laura, this next question number three, is your opportunity to give a shout out to an animal studies scholar that you think listeners should be aware of, and it could be someone who is perhaps emerging or someone who is working in an adjacent field but perhaps mightn't be front and centre in the minds of animal studies scholars. Could also be someone who's working in a language other than English. Who do you want to give your shout out to?
I would love to give a shout out to Hayley Singer, whose work in Australia would be very well known in the animal studies community. Hayley is just such an extraordinary researcher, thinker. Her work on the idea around the Fleischgeist, which I think is the meat, oh gosh, I've forgotten the interpretation, the meat ghost, I think. And she has a book coming out. Her work around that is so extraordinary. But also as a person, Hayley has been so influential on me. I had the great privilege of sharing an office with her at one point. And her ideas, especially around ecofeminism, really broadened my mind. She was always so generous with her knowledge, her very deep knowledge, and she's relentless at pursuing new knowledge at all times and in such exciting areas. So anyone who hasn't read Hayley's work, it is an absolute delight, and it is such a privilege to see the world through Hayley's perspective in her writing.
Yeah, Hayley is lovely, and Sue actually gave her Suzanne Pye gave her shout out to Hayley. So there's a lot of pressure on Hayley for this novel. We'll be looking out for and Hayley's got a new soundscape project coming up that will hopefully be part of the iRaw podcasting network. So yes, she's very, very busy and doing a lot of important work.
She's so busy. It's amazing.
Well, Laura, are you optimistic about the future of human-non-human animal relations?
Oh, I'm such a pessimist at heart and a cynic. I guess the short answer is I'm not. I don't think that humans will change our ways. I think we're bent on destruction of ourselves and everything else. Having said that, I do see that there is an animal turn. There is a turn towards animals and environment. And I think if humans try really, really hard, we can actually, if not do some good, then reverse a lot of the damage that we've been doing. And there are people trying really, really hard. So there is hope in that. And also non-human animals are often extraordinary. They adapt in amazing ways no matter what we do. So I always take heart and hope in trying to learn from them as well.
Yeah, I've taken a little bit of hope and heart from the seeming instances of animals really reclaiming spaces that humans have exited due to the pandemic. It makes me think maybe that they'll be okay.
I hope so. It is really lovely. Those scenes of reclaiming and rewilding are just so exciting.
Well, Laura, what are you working on next?
I'm looking at a few different things. I'm turning my eye to extinction. It's something that I avoided for a long time because I thought it was just too sad. But now I realise that that's a disgusting way to behave, and that I'm in a position that I can actually do something at least through literature. So I'm looking at extinction from a theoretical perspective. But I'm a baby extinction researcher, so very new to that. And I'm also looking creatively at water. So turning to the watery world, the oceans. There's a whale scene in my novel that I was really interested in, and I'd like to continue that sort of work.
Fantastic. So how can people find out more about your work?
Hello?
Hi, can you hear me? Hello?
Hello?
Laura, can you hear me? I can hear you.
Oh, hello. Oh, sorry. I think suddenly there was a Bluetooth problem, but I'm back.
Oh, okay. That's okay. We're back. Hello? Oh. So what I did say was, how can people find out more about your work?
Oh, right. Thank you. Okay. So you could probably just go to the Scribe website, and you could find out more about the animals in that country there. And also there's a little bit about my other book and the other work that I do. And I'm also on Twitter a little bit too much, so you're welcome to come on there and have a chat as well.
Yeah. And so my encouragement is that people think about getting themselves a copy of the animals in that country. But if you can't afford it, or even if you can afford it, I'd also strongly encourage people to think about asking your institutional library to buy a copy, and because of the nature of the book, even your local library, because I think it is a really nice read, and it would be wonderful for it to have homes in libraries so people, you know, can share it and have access to it even if they can't afford to buy it.
I would be so thrilled by that. I'm from a family of librarians, so love libraries. Local libraries, university libraries, and often libraries are really innovative in moving into ebooks and audiobooks as well, and the book's available in both those formats. Please do ask your local to get it in.
Wonderful. Well, Laura, thank you so much for joining us.
It's been such a delight to talk to you again. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. And thank you to the listeners for joining us for Knowing Animals, the podcast where we talk to animal studies scholars about their work. Now, you can also find us on Twitter at @knowing_animals. Knowing Animals has a Facebook account and Instagram feed. And finally, don't forget to leave a review. Reviews make it easier for other people to find us. I'm Siobhan O'Sullivan, and I do like knowing animals. For more great iRaw podcasts, visit iRawPod.com. That's IRoarPod.com.